Sensitive dependence on initial conditions is also known as the butterfly effect. You've probably heard this term before and know the story, but I should mention it briefly. So again, the butterfly effect, here's this illustration. We have two different initial conditions. This is for the x part of the Lorentz equations. Two different initial conditions that differ by a tiny, tiny, tiny amount. We can think of this as 15 meters, and this is 15 meters plus 10 nanometers. Imperceptible, meaninglessly different. And here is the trajectory, the orbit, of the two solutions. One we could think of as reality, one as prediction. And here, after, about 18 minutes or 18 time steps, the two curves go apart. So a tiny change, this is the idea, like the effects of a butterfly flapping its wings, can make a large difference later on. So maybe, speaking somewhat metaphorically, this is somehow the path of a hurricane, and in this version it hits New York City, and in this version it hits North Carolina. So the difference, and maybe this is wind speed or something 20 hours ago or 20 days ago, who knows. And so this tiny difference could be caused by the flapping of a butterfly's wings. So very small changes in initial circumstances can lead to very large changes later on. And this is what makes phenomena like this essentially unpredictable, because we can never measure something like this. In fact, maybe values this accurate might not even be physically meaningful. James Gleick, in his book Chaos, has a nice way of thinking about the butterfly effect, in particular, the influence or the effect of a butterfly flapping its wings. And he says the following: it's like giving an extra shuffle to a deck of already well-shuffled cards. You know that it will change your luck, but there's no way of knowing how it will change it. So that's sort of how I think about the butterfly here. A butterfly might flap its wings, and we know it's going to change something in the future, but we don't know how it will change it. Here's another way to think about the butterfly effect. In our lives, we might be accustomed to the idea that there were particular moments where a small change in something that we did led to a really big change in the course of our life. So a simple example might be you burn the toast, and so you're a little bit late leaving the house, and so you catch a train that's one later than the train you thought you were going to take, but the train that you had been planning on taking crashed and a lot of people died. So, okay, that's a dramatic example, but we can perhaps think of a number of times in our life where we were at sort of a key decision point and some very small thing, maybe that we didn't know about at the time, made a big difference later on. It's sort of like a ball perched on top of a hill. A tiny little change will determine whether or not the ball rolls down to the right or to the left. So the idea that we have these sort of sudden decision points is a fairly commonplace one. But in a system that has sensitive dependence on initial conditions, it's as if every moment is a decision point. At every moment, the future trajectory is poised between possible different futures, and the difference between those is a tiny little flap of a gust of wind from a butterfly flapping its wings that determines which path it will go on. So it's this continuous sensitivity where at every point along the journey, a tiny change can make a big change later on, and there's no way to know what those changes will be. Finally, before moving on to talk about chaos, I should mention that there's a really interesting history to this term, the butterfly effect. And I strongly recommend, there's a short article by Hilborn in American Journal of Physics. There's a link to it on the Complexity Explorer page right down there underneath this video. It's a three-page non-technical piece. If you're interested at all in the history of this term, it's a great read. I definitely recommend it. Okay, so let me conclude this subunit by defining chaos. We're finally in a position where we can define chaos in the mathematical sense. So a dynamical system, we would say, is chaotic if it meets the following four criteria. First, the dynamical system has to be deterministic. The two types of dynamical systems we've studied so far, and which are the topic of this course, iterated functions and differential equations are most certainly deterministic. As I've stressed throughout the first two units, the dynamical system is just a deterministic rule. If you know the rule and you know the initial condition, the trajectory is unique. It's determined. Let me skip over two. I'll do these so let me say this. The system's orbits are bounded, meaning they can't fly off to infinity. So for the logistic equation, we've seen that orbits that start between 0 and 1 remain between 0 and 1. For a system to be chaotic, the orbits also have to be aperiodic, i.e. they never repeat. They never follow the exact same path twice. It doesn't go into a cycle. So if the orbits were not bounded, let's say that we had just the doubling function, then we could have an orbit that would be aperiodic, right? If you double a number, it just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger forever, and it never repeats. So that's not so interesting. So this requirement that the orbits be bounded is sort of like fine print that eliminates the possibility of orbits going off to infinity. So if we have bounded orbits that are aperiodic, that are confined to stay in a unit interval or a square or something, and yet nevertheless never repeat. And then the last criteria for something to be chaotic is that it has to have sensitive dependence on initial conditions in the sense that we've just been talking about. So if a dynamical system has these four properties, then in physics or math, we'll say it's chaotic. There's lots more to say about the implications of sensitive dependence on initial conditions, and in general on chaotic dynamical systems. We'll talk about this in the rest of this unit and in many ways in the rest of the course. But in the next set of lectures, I'd like to explore this idea that a dynamical system, a deterministic dynamical system, is capable of producing random behavior. And in order to dig into this idea, we'll need to start by thinking about what it even means to call something random. So this will be the topic of the next lecture.